What determines the worth of a man? His income, social status, level of education? Or is it his own ability to rise above the most dire of circumstances to make a good name for himself in this world? Looking forward to getting up in the morning and conquering the day, to hold his head up high. Well, I'm Nelson Davis, executive producer of Making It. And on today's show, we'll meet an extraordinary individual, a man who went from being an illiterate convict to millionaire business owner. How could someone sink so low, then rise so high? It's a fascinating story, which we invite you to watch right now on Making It. Making It, featuring inspiring personal stories of struggle, triumph, and success from America's small business communities.
Hello and welcome to Making It. I'm Lynette Romero.
And I'm Emmett Miller. Thanks for joining us.
We're about to tell you one of the more riveting stories we've ever told here on Making It. It's the story of a little boy growing up impoverished. His father was in prison for attempted murder, and his mother was so strung out on drugs that he never even knew who she was until he was 11 years old. His days were spent struggling just to find enough to eat and a roof over his head.
Yes, life for John L. Langerston was about as rough as it gets. And if you think this takes place in a third world country, think again. His life began right here in the U.S., on the streets of Oakland, California. After being shuffled from one relative to another, from one home to another, he finally started school in the sixth grade. But now he had another problem. He'd never learned to read.
Well, if you think someone like John L. Langerston is destined to wind up in prison, you're right. But if you think that's the end of this story, that's the wrong presumption, because this formerly illiterate convict who was thrown away found redemption by his own force of will. And he now owns a multi-million dollar company. Xiomara Galindo takes us deeper into the story of a man who transformed his life.
We start off going from concept to reality. We do design. We do printing. We do CD manufacturing. We do urban marketing and production, which is the bus benches, the banners, the vehicle wraps. And as well, we do EPKs, which is electronic press kits for independents. And now recently, we joined ventures with Dexter Brown Photography, which is a famous photographer. So we can also capture the images before we design them.
Where can we see your designs?
Almost everywhere. No, just the stores throughout the, throughout each state. The bus benches is in California. We control the bus benches, a large portion of the urban bus benches in the urban communities. When you see the hip-hop stuff out there, a lot of times that was us.
Most of the entrepreneurs that we've highlighted here on Making It have had some sort of a challenge that they've had to overcome. Yours carried through from childhood to young adult life. Tell us about those troubles.
My childhood is very simple. You know, just like most children that grew up in an urban community, the difference was me, my mom is white, my dad is black. I grew up in a time and era when that wasn't really proper, during the Huey Newton era in the 60s. I don't want to tell my age, but at that time, I just had to go through maybe 9 different elementary schools, if I'm not correct, before I even had a chance to meet my mom and find out she was white. And it kind of, you know, left me behind in catching on to the basic things of life, reading, writing, things that you really have to learn at that age. And so at that point, I just got disconnected from the educational profile of life.
By his teenage years, John L. became interested in running track. He did so well that he earned a college scholarship, but an injury ended both his sports and college careers and landed him back on the streets of Oakland, California. There he turned to a life of drugs and crime and ultimately became known as a drug kingpin.
Selling drugs, I'm not highlighting that. I really thank God for changing my spirit to the way it is today. But you have to admire the traditional state of mind of any traditional drug dealer on this planet from an urban perspective as someone from a business. The willingness to work under long hours, under demanding conditions, salesmanship, supply and demand. I mean, these things are the same attributes that any traditional businessman must have in order to succeed as a businessman.
John L. was arrested in 1987 and served a decade of his life in prison.
People don't realize you do 10 years in prison as a first-time offender. It's like, whoa. I spent 4 of that 10 years in the hole. One in particular time, I spent a year straight. In that time, I had to come into understanding myself as a human on this planet. And when I say that, I mean the spirit in which I perceive myself as being as a man. Learning how to read and write was so important to me that I started learning one word a day, just to catch on to the simple words, the, at, off, things that you think I'd automatically know. So in the process of understanding this time, I had to humble myself and find myself.
After Jonell was released from prison, he started working with some friends doing marketing for the entertainment industry.
Thomas and Tracy Underwood are two business partners of mine in the Bay Area. We had a company called Funky Fat Graphics. At the time, Thomas and Tracy had become very popular at creating a lot of the images like for the Masterpiece, the E-40s, and establishing themselves. Well, my goal when I came home from prison was to figure out what can I do to get in that niche.
Jonell came up with the idea to put hip-hop ads on bus benches.
It was a time when the outdoor advertisement had kind of fell at a slope because of the tobacco industry. You couldn't no longer advertise outside. You didn't see hip-hop on bus benches. So I located the people who started the whole theme of the bus benches and look, these benches is empty. Let me work with them. And they kind of laughed at me because hip-hop was hip-hop. And I'm like, well, hey, you know what, I tell you what. If that's the case, if I do this deal, you know, let me control the ones in the urban communities. And they was like, okay. So Master P and E-40 really made it possible for me to be able to do that.
How did you end up here at this place on Main Street?
In the Bay Area, I have become very popular at being in the position to design and print and produce a lot of the stuff that you've seen in the urban communities. So I felt that I could come to Los Angeles as a so-called, you know, one who can establish one's image and really establish my presence there. I was on parole, I picked up, got a 90-day pass, and drove to Los Angeles in an old car, and I just really drove around everywhere. One day in my car, I drove 8 tanks of gas out, just driving, looking. And then I spotted this particular place, and I was like, hold up, I gotta have that. And I went from there.
Tell me about your first project.
I had a small place, and my first client that came in, I had one little computer. And he was like, man, L, you gonna be able to do this? I say, man, I can do it. He said, well, I believe you. I'm gonna hook you up with this guy. And this gentleman happened to be in, on vacation with me as well. He brought in Barry Hankerson and them crew, which gave me the movie soundtrack to Romeo Must Die. And I had a chance to produce a large portion of the product that went out on that particular project. And it made a name for myself.
Boy, talking about threadbare starts.
And this is just the beginning of the story. Mm. There's more to come. Of the 2 million inmates who will be released from U.S. prisons this year, statistics tell us that 60 to 80% of them will return within just a couple of years. How Jonell avoided that trap by focusing on his business, we'll tell you about that coming up later in the show.
While Jonell was in the hole, he began to set his goals that would turn his life around. In Secrets of Success, best-selling author Jack Canfield says, that's how you program your unconscious mind and you keep yourself focused.
If you want to be more successful in life, you have to start setting goals. Research shows that only 3% of Americans ever set goals at the beginning of the year. And it's those same 3% who are running the economy, who are the leaders of our business and the top salespeople. Without goals, you end up getting used by and working for people who have them. And so each year you want to take at the beginning of the year some time and make a list of all the goals that you want to achieve in that year. And then even if you just put them in a drawer and never looked at them, research says you'll actually achieve more. But more importantly, if you will read that list of goals every day, just one time, it begins to program your unconscious, keeps you focused, and you start having creative ideas and start noticing all the things in the world that can help you achieve your goals. So make sure that you make a list of everything you want to achieve and make it measurable and specific. It's not enough to say, I want a house on the ocean. Say, I will own a 4,000 square foot house on Pacific Coast Highway in Malibu by January 1st, 2007. And if you'll do that with every goal and review those every day, you'll be surprised at what starts happening in your life.
Okay, only 500,000 square foot. Jack Canfield's the author of the best-selling Chicken Soup for the Soul series. His latest book is entitled The Secrets, The Success Principles. To learn more about it, you can log on to his website at successprinciples.com. And for more secrets of success, log on to our website at makingit.com.
And coming up next, how Jonell Langerston is using his life lessons and thriving business to steer young people onto the right path. We'll have more on this remarkable entrepreneur when we return.
Supporting the small business community in America. Making It is being brought to you by Honda, the power of dreams. By Comerica Bank, we listen, we understand, we make it work. And by Southern California Edison, for over 100 years, life powered by Edison.
And welcome back to Making It. On today's show, we're taking a look at the life of John L. Langerston, a man who went from drug kingpin to convicted felon to hip-hop marketing mastermind.
When John L. went to prison, he was barely able to read, and he wasn't alone. The New Jersey Department of Corrections reports that 70% of its inmates are functioning at the lowest literacy levels. Yet only 2% of the prison budget is spent on educating inmates.
And consequently, when many of them are released, they don't have any skills that translate well into the corporate world. Almost no one will hire them. But interestingly enough, the transition from successful criminal to successful entrepreneur draws upon some shared principles.
John L. was lucky to catch a break from friends in the hip-hop marketing business. It's an explosive industry. Hip-hop music accounted for 25% of U.S. record sales in 2003, topping the $3 billion mark.
Ziamaro Galindo has the story, John L.'s story, the continuation of how he explains that what he picked up on the streets became the key to the success of Fat FX.
John L., give me a description of your business in the early days when you were working out of a one-room facility.
When you first start a company, a lot of times you can't afford to buy a lot of stuff, so you have to buy what you can. iMac at the time came out with a good rate as well as the G4s, and then, of course, I had one press. So, you know, I couldn't really afford to do a lot. And if you can't afford to pay people the hours that it take to keep a job going, you'd find yourself there 24/7 and trying to make sure you accomplish your goals.
What has been the greatest lesson in growing your business?
It's interesting. I think the greatest lesson for me is being able to live up to every obligation that I commit to. Every time I say I'm gonna do something, I do it. That way it don't never have a question. I'm an urban dude. I don't speak the corporate language, so I have no choice but to prove in action.
You have several clients in the music industry. How did you establish those relationships?
It's almost like coming through the back door, the mailroom routine. The streets demand a certain look. If your product is not already looking like the stuff I filtered to the street from an urban perspective for independence, then it'll get thrown away. So now it forced other individuals who are on the street teams passing that product out to say, wait a minute, this flyer don't look as good as this. We need to call whoever doing this. So I come from the back door up, and then my pricing be to the point where, wait a minute, you sure it costs just that much? So it's way cheaper, way more effective, much more, you know, vibrant in colors. And so what can they do? They have to start looking. And voila, one step at a time.
Your journey in the business world continues. Tell us where Fat FX is today in regards to gross income.
I mean, I'm a millionaire, you know what I mean? What can I say? I don't think it's good to pop your collar on that. I think that at this point, I come from something that wasn't, you know, what it is today, and I thank God for my blessings. I have much more of an influence over my urban community now because of the fact that I've been blessed to achieve the goals that I have. When I go out to talk to them and discuss things that can change their life, they're willing to listen now, and that's what means something to me.
Where do you rate as far as similar businesses, and how do you stay ahead of the competition?
A lot of the great, you know, millionaires on this planet today always said you have to diversify, step into new areas and new things. So what I've done is, again, I started with design, went from design to doing printing, from printing to doing, you know, CD manufacturing, from CD manufacturing to vehicle wrap, from vehicle wraps into bus bench advertising, from bus bench advertising to electronic press kits. And even our electronic press kits now has progressed into, you know, each time I look for a way to fulfill the niche of the market in each area, and it helps me continue to grow.
Do you have any plans to start other businesses?
Yeah, I have an idea about doing like an Urban Born. You know, Urban Born is like a company that I like working with kids. I go in, I have a unique way of educating kids on how not to follow the path. Since we've been fortunate enough to do a large portion of the hip-hop stuff, we use that as tools. We have the artists come in, sign posters, flyers, stickers, and et cetera, to pass out to the actual kids in the schools as if they paid attention, and I'd ask a question. If they got the question right, they'd get a prize. And my goal is to do that really a lot more. I feel at ease in that moment because kids really can identify with my soul.
Unfortunately, many kids seem to get lost along the way. What advice do you have for them?
I don't believe the youngsters today get lost. Unfortunately, corporate America think that they're lost because they're surviving in an environment that they have to be who they are in order to walk down that block. And in their state of mind, they're not lost. They're actually right there in what's happening. But I do also know that tomorrow morning, they can wake up and be different. They can wake up tomorrow morning with a bullet in them and they'll never want to walk that way again. They can wake up tomorrow morning and have cancer and never want to be that way again. A young kid can wake up tomorrow morning and be pregnant and she'd never want to act. You understand what I'm saying? Don't wait until some tragedy happened to wake up and be different. Those kids are not lost. They just need a reason to wake up tomorrow morning and be different.
As someone who has truly turned his life around, what tools do you think a person needs to be able to make it?
Tools is so important. Learn how to learn, period. Sixth, seventh, and eighth grade, at that point, just learn how to learn. That way, you understand that you do need to learn. At what level of intensity you learn at is what you get out of life.
Many people find it very difficult to adjust to life after being outside of prison. How were you able to succeed?
I like what life has to offer. You know, I love watching people smile. I love the attitude that one gives when you smile at them. And just the whole feeling of life and just the inspiration of it. Some of the brothers is coming home without that feeling because they already losing a major ingredient. No education. No real workman skills. What are they gonna, they don't even know how to talk corporate language. So the only jobs available to them are remedial jobs. And unfortunately, they're not gonna go and stand up tall as a soldier on this planet and work at McDonald's. It's just, they're not gonna do that. You have to give them something they can identify with. That's why music is so relieving.
How do you feel living in this unbelievable home when you had such humble beginnings?
I'm not comfortable. I'm very grateful for what God has given me, but every day I'm right there dealing with people. I don't need no jewelry, no fancy cars. I got all the old cars though, but still, you know, I feel like there's a gap missing. And so I look every morning and I thank God and I look at that image and I say, wow, I still got a long ways to go, even though we've traveled a long ways.
He's captivating.
He really is, yeah.
And so good to see him out there with the kids. They're looking at him. You can see they're looking at him, and he can communicate and really catch their attention.
And he understands them, and I think that they feel that, you know?
They're looking up to him.
And, you know, some of his more famous clients include Beyonce, Nas, Mariah Carey. He continues to diversify his business as well. And you know what? He's also reconnected with both his parents, and finally they have a good relationship.
Wow. Well, coming up next, we'll tell you how you can contact John L. And our studio guest is Dr. Tom Bay. He'll tell us what traits all winners share and how we can change our lives by what we think. Don't go away.
Okay, here's how you can get in touch with the entrepreneur you've met on today's show. You can contact John L. Langerston at FatFX. Their phone number is 323-276-5060 or log on to his website at FatFX.com. And now here's Lynette with today's studio guest, Dr. Tom Bay.
Thanks, Emmett. Dr. Tom Bay is the author of several books, including his latest, Change Your Attitude. The book explains how you can create your own success one thought at a time. He's also a highly sought-out motivational speaker employed by corporate giants such as AT&T, Marriott, Qualcomm, and Sony. Welcome to Making It. We appreciate
you
being here.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Now, first of all, let's say the name of your book again. The title is Change Your Attitude, Creating Success One Thought at a Time. So you say changing your attitude can really change your life. How so?
Absolutely. It's a reflection of who you are. And even at times when you think you may be hiding it, mm-hmm. those around you can pick up on it immediately. So if you're giving off a positive attitude and you really do feel it, it shows. If you're pretending it's positive and it really isn't, mm-hmm. it shows as well.
You just can't act.
Yeah.
It doesn't work. It's hard to hold that act the whole time.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, we talk about having a good attitude as being really important in business. How can a person assess their attitude and find out if it's working for them?
It's real easy. First of all, you've got to take responsibility. And in doing that, you have to look at yourself. And if you find yourself consistently blaming others, finding that it's not really your responsibility. We live, for instance, I feel very strongly about this, in a victim society today. Mm-hmm. We have a tendency to find that everything's going wrong, including my attitude, is someone else's fault. Mm-hmm. Students will say, well, it's my teacher's fault, it's my professor's fault, it's my spouse's fault, it's my kids, it's my boss. And what it really boils down to, it's a reflection of who you are inside.
Right. But you have to be honest with yourself
Absolutely.
About it.
Absolutely.
You talk about having a right attitude and a wrong attitude.
Right.
Can you give me examples of both?
Well, the right attitude, you've hit one of them. Right attitude is, first of all, taking responsibility, being involved with your life and showing some integrity about it. Mm-hmm. Setting goals is real important. Being honest with yourself, as you had mentioned, is real important. And also being aware of the fact you've got to dedicate some time to yourself to keep that positive attitude. We have 1,440 minutes a day. That's all we have. That's everything we're ever going to have. Mm-hmm. And it's 1,440. No matter how you slice it, pack it, dice it, it's still 1,440 minutes.
Can you give us some very specific steps to develop the right attitude? You may really want to do it, but, you know, are you doing it right? How do you do that?
First of all, it's important to set down ideas on paper, thinking about them and what have you. Some of the things that people don't do is take some time to soul search. One of the perfect times to do it is we have a tendency when we get into a vehicle, it's almost habit. We reach to turn on the radio or the CD.
Mm-hmm. Or I talk always, on the phone.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And you know, or get a fax or whatever it is mm-hmm. today we can do in our car.
Right.
But I say, just give yourself, because you're so important, give yourself 1 minute of nothing. Don't turn the radio on. Consciously think, I'm going to just focus on myself for a bit. Mm-hmm. In many cases, you know what you'll find out, Lynette? You'll drive 50 miles and not realize you've never turned it on because the conversation is so interesting.
Right.
And you start assessing some things about your life and what you need to be doing with it and where you'd like to go.
You start out with a minute, but you really need more than that.
Absolutely. Yeah. But start with a minute.
Can you give us some more examples on some tips to set clear goals and stick to them? We heard somebody say about writing them down every day, telling yourself every day. You agree with that?
Yeah, Jack had mentioned that. That is so vital because we are so busy today. The goals need to be written down. And oftentimes what I will tell individuals that I've worked with, not only do you write it down in your planner or paper that you carry around with you on the day as part of your task, mm-hmm. make sure you have some steps to make sure you meet your goals. Another thing you can do is put it on a sticky note. And mm-hmm. put it on the mirror. When you're getting shaving in the morning, putting on makeup, mm-hmm. there's a reflection there that you can read that note to remind yourself, mm-hmm. I have these goals for today or for this week.
Right.
So you stay focused.
And when you don't meet those goals?
When you don't meet those goals, guess who you're looking at in the mirror? It's back to reassessing again. What do I need to do differently? What haven't I done that I said I was going to do?
Right.
What did I overlook?
You're in control of your destiny. Thank
exactly.
you so much. Great tips. Thank you, Tom. We'll tell you how you can contact Dr. Tom Bay right after this break, so stick around.
The entrepreneurial spirit is alive and well at Making It, which is being brought to you by the Disneyland Resort. You're invited to the happiest homecoming on Earth. By the Boeing Company, and by Sempra Energy, a Fortune 500 energy services company committed to building a diverse supplier base.
And you can reach Tom Bay at 888-440-8000 or log on to his website at tombay.com.
And if you'd like to get a copy of today's show or to find other small business resources, just log on to our website at makingittv.com.
And I think we'd both agree that the theme of the show today was transformational abilities. It doesn't matter where you're starting from, what the tools were that you were giving, it's what you're doing with those tools right now to make it what you want it to be.
Another thing Dr. Tom Bay said is, it's your life. What are you going to do about it?
You know,
it's true. It is so true. What are you going to do about it?
Take a nap? That's our show for this week. I'm Emmett Miller.
And I'm Lynette Romero. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time right here on Making It.
You youngsters out there, stay focused. Every day, you can make a difference if you step forward, one step at a time. Each step I've made, I had to prove it. I don't speak the corporate language. I don't have the corporate look. I never allowed that to be the reason I didn't get the corporate dollar.
In the last 20 years, the number of minority-owned businesses in this country has more than doubled, and they're now about 15% of all American enterprises. Totaling more than 3 million, these firms and their owners have at least one thing in common. That's sheer will and persistence. Novelist James Baldwin said that flaming enthusiasm, backed up by horse sense and persistence, is the quality that most frequently makes for success. I'm Nelson Davis, executive producer of Making It, and you'll meet two of those special people next.
Making It, featuring inspiring personal stories of struggle, triumph, and success from America's small business communities.
And welcome to Making It. I'm Lynette Romero.
And I'm Emmett Miller. Thanks for joining us.
Salsa music has important social and cultural meaning. It sets no limits between age and class. Salsa originated in New York as a result of a diverse mixture of Afro-Caribbean music and North American jazz and rock. It has since migrated all over the world.
And there's no place like Los Angeles, no place like its salsa clubs. LA's strongest salsa promoter is Albert Torres. He lives and breathes this music 24 hours a day.
Albert Torres has overcome a disastrous personal life. He was living in San Francisco when one day he visited a salsa club and found reason for being, he says. He thought of the large Latin population in Los Angeles and lack of salsa clubs.
While building his company for 3 years, Albert had to sleep on friends' couches and go days without eating. But he never lost sight of his goal. Through persistence, he turned his dream into a reality.
We do salsa events, which comes from the mambo and the cha-cha-cha and basically Latin music.
Albert Torres Productions has five arms to the business.
They start everything from local clubs that people can go to and learn lessons, and it's all ages, to then going and doing salsa congresses around the world, where we're doing 14 of them, to also putting together a world salsa championship in Las Vegas next year, to saying that you're having a wedding, a bar mitzvah, or a get-together. And another arm of the business is that we have bands to dancers that will go to your event, whether it's a corporate event or a get-together, and we'll take care of that. And then we have music seminars where we teach children and we teach grown-ups on the culture and the education of this music.
It was a winding path that brought Albert Torres to the world of salsa music. After spending the first 12 years of his life in New York, his mother moved the family to Puerto Rico.
We didn't speak Spanish. I didn't really want to be Latin. I didn't want to be anything but show me the disco music, let me have fun with American. I'm American. And when we got to Puerto Rico, I was basically a rebel. But because of the gift of music, because of the gift of salsa and something called Fania All-Stars, the music, Johnny Pacheco, Willie Colon, Hector Lavoe, Rey Barreto, Tito Puente, Celia Cruz, something happened within my core being where I wanted to learn about the African music and where it had come from.
You faced some personal obstacles in your life. Can you share them with us?
It's been a roller coaster of a life that I've had. First 12 years dealt with physical abuse, sexual abuse, and I had to work through that. And what ended up happening after the age of 12 and a half, going to a new country, I'm not using this as an excuse, but due to the circumstances that occurred in my life, I found that if a substance was put into my body, I could feel numb, and it didn't matter what color my skin was. It didn't matter what my body had gone through or what had been done to me, or if I spoke the language or didn't speak the language, I could function on a daily basis.
Albert had substance abuse issues for 17 and a half years.
December 14th of 1985, I went to my first 12-step meeting, and coincidentally today, the day that I'm having this interview, I'm celebrating 19 years clean and sober. But it wasn't just that. Even through sobriety, just because you get sober doesn't mean you don't switch seats on the Titanic. And basically, I switched seats.
I went
to another addiction, and my other addiction was gambling.
At Albert's lowest point, he even considered suicide. Now he combats his addictions by taking it day by day. He has found a new passion to occupy his mind.
Albert Torres Productions started out of the gambling. When I realized that some things came to a halt, where some money that I had taken to cover some gambling debts were becoming legal problems, I realized that the job that I used to do, helping in a treatment center, wasn't going to be my future anymore. And that's when I wanted to blow my head off. And in the process of sitting down, some older people at a 12-step meeting said, you know, if you had anything in your life that you could do, what would it be? And, well, I'd love to dance, I'd love to teach people, I'd love to maybe spread this music. but I'm never going to make a living from it. And they said, you can do anything you want as long as you stay clean, as long as you don't gamble today. Whatever your dream is, you can do it.
The beginning of the business was faced with seemingly insurmountable circumstances.
The company started the first 3 years losing everything I had, plus a lot more, over $100,000 in debt. And there was nowhere to get the money. Every credit card that I ever imagined that I would have was up to the top and its max. But there were individuals and people that loved me unconditionally and supported, would take me out to breakfast at night. Other people let me sleep on their couches and lend me a little bit of money to pay the rent so that I would make it to the next month. But there was a perseverance there inside of my heart that when I woke up every morning, I knew this is what I wanted to do.
Albert's wife, Maya, helped him grow the business to the next level. What are the costs involved?
A local club, if I'm having a live band there, can go anything from $2,500 to $3,500 for that evening just to put it on between having my employees at the door, the marketing that goes behind that certain function, person answering the phone, to then the band and the DJ, and the cleaning up afterwards. If it's just a DJ, probably around $1,500 to put the function on.
In 1998, Albert joined a partner to do a salsa congress in Puerto Rico. Now, Albert Torres Productions produces the salsa congresses both locally and internationally.
The LA Salsa Congress is $250,000 to $500,000 project. We build a city called Salsa Land on the Hollywood Park Casino grounds. We call it Salsa Land because we're not able to fit in any one location. And the size of Salsa Land is 176,000 square feet, which is the size of 4 football fields. And what we do is we build a whole pavilion of everything from places where you can sit and watch the dancers perform to watching the live bands and dancing to it, over 15,000 square feet of dance floor.
Having an exemplary reputation among salsa enthusiasts is very important to you. Tell us about your philosophy in salsa.
The logo of my company is creating unity through salsa. And what we could do is create unity because as long as we're all dancing, there could be no wars.
Talk about remaking your life,
yeah,
huh?
No kidding.
And successfully. Albert's mission is to bring Latin music around the world. His next goal, start a record label. Albert Torres.
Albert Torres knows how important it is to promote an impeccable image in Secrets of Success. Anthony Mora of Anthony Mora Communications suggests that when you send out a press release, make sure it represents the best of who you are.
So what is a press release? A press release is your media calling card. This is you you're sending to the media. So you want it to look good and you want it to read well. You want it to be one page long. That's the law. It can't go for 4 or 5 pages. You're not writing your biography. You're not telling your whole story. You're just catching someone's interest. So make it interesting. Think backwards. Think what the media's needs are. Meet their needs with your stories. If you're a physician, for example, your story is your patient's success story. It's not that you're an expert always. Make it concise. Make it clear. Make sure you have someone proof it. Make sure it's grammatically correct. Once it's ready to go, get a list of where you're going to send it. Send it in plenty of time. Be sure you have your name and your phone number there so they know how to contact you. Nothing's worse than to get somebody interested and they don't know where you are. So once you've got it out there, send it out. Remember, this is you you're sending to the media. So make it the best you you can be.
And to learn more about Anthony Mora and the importance of writing a press release, just visit his website at anthonymora.com. And for more Secrets of Success, you can log on to our website at makingittv.com.
And coming up next, the will to succeed can be a powerful motivating force. It can help one triumph in seemingly overwhelming circumstances. Our next entrepreneur noticed a lack of urban representation in the world of film and television and used it as fuel. Fuel to start a new production company and do it successfully. Back in a minute.
Supporting the entrepreneurial spirit in America, Making It is being brought to you by Southern California Edison. For over 100 years, life powered by Edison. And by the Boeing Company.
And welcome back to Making It. Many talented urban filmmakers have been overlooked by the major studios and the networks.
On today's show, we meet an entrepreneur dedicated to exploring untapped entrepreneurial opportunities in the film and TV business. Working for the CEO of a major studio, he found that many executives were arrogant when it came to considering the value of the hip-hop market.
Will Griffin established Simmons Latham Media Group to showcase under-recognized talent in the urban entertainment category.
Will convinced two captains in the media world, Russell Simmons and Stan Latham, to partner with him and form a new venture dedicated to developing writers, directors, and producers. Very interested, they asked him to put together a business plan, and they said that he had to raise nearly all of the capital.
The company, Simmons Latham Media Group, is currently producing some exciting projects and forming powerful relationships within the industry.
Will's philosophy in business is to, quote, go for it and not leave anything on the table.
When you're in the media business, 9/10 of what it is that happens, all of it's a dream. You know, somebody made it up one day, and then the next day, you know, it's not happening in one day, but, you know, over time, then that's something that is shared with millions of people.
Will Griffin's dreams directed him toward greatness. After receiving undergraduate and law degrees from Dartmouth and Harvard, respectively, he made a beeline for Wall Street.
When I got in, I kind of realized that, you know, it's not just about the money for me. You know, I ultimately want to have an impact and do something, you know, do something for culture. And as far as I'm concerned, advance my culture, which I consider to be, you know, African-American culture.
Combining his love for urban culture with the highest level of preparation, Will says he knew the hard part was not getting a meeting with hip-hop mogul Russell Simmons or famed director Stan Latham.
The way rappers carry around, you know, notebooks full of rhymes, or the way producers carry beats in their head, you know, I used to doodle and, you know, carry around business plans, you know, and ideas about what I thought could be done differently in this industry, that if I had the opportunity to make a difference or get involved with people who are players, I'd be able to do it.
What Griffin saw was an opportunity to turn what had essentially been limited successful business projects for Simmons and Latham into ongoing business entities that were self-contained.
My belief was that you can actually scale that up. So instead of doing one franchise at a time, you could do half a dozen or dozens of franchises at a time, which that can happen if we go out and we find filmmakers and producers and television directors and producers and film directors and producers and pods of production teams who could create content. And so that way, Stan wouldn't have to direct every episode. Russell wouldn't have to appear in every episode.
Will's prospective partners agreed with him that there was a major void in the marketplace, and they were collectively determined to fill it.
I think that there was a blind spot on the part of Hollywood, and there's a supply side problem. So just based on the basic economics 101, supply and demand, I believe that there's more demand than there is a supply of urban film and TV content. And I felt like that our company could solve that.
With Russell Simmons and Stan Latham committed to the idea, now came the challenge of raising the large sum of money needed to fund the operation.
Well, when I think about how we're going to wind up, I usually try to figure out where it is that we want to be and how much it's going to take us to get there, and then try to get the investors or the distribution partners or the financiers to buy in on the whole picture from the very beginning. So when you think of it that way, it's a tens of millions of dollars proposition.
Holding firm to his belief in himself, Will refused to take money from his partners, committing to raising the startup capital independent of Simmons and Latham.
At one point, I met Russell down in D.C. We went to go talk to the CENTCOM. That's where they're based, the investors. And, you know, and I flew out there, and then, you know, he said, you must really think you're going to make some money with me. You know, I must really believe it, because I was spending time and effort and energy and my own resources as though I really believed it, and I really did.
The most challenging aspect of his business is being able to pull all of the pieces together.
One of the things that's often overlooked is in music, you know, the barriers to entry are very low. Look, if I can make a beat right here on the table and I can freestyle and rhyme, I could prove to somebody that, you know, I may be ready for the big time. You can't do that with film. You need equipment, you need a stage, you need access to actors. You need to do a lot of things in order to be prepared.
And yet, sometimes the best laid plans go awry. Simmons Latham Media Group's deal with Encore Stars fell through.
Encore Stars was in a dispute with Comcast, which was the major distributor. The result of it is that the amount that Comcast was paying them for their content and their service was going to be cut. Now, as a result, Encore Stars didn't have as much money in their budget to pay for programming.
But the setback hasn't stopped them from pressing forward.
Something that's kind of exciting that we just recently announced is we have a joint venture with Clear Channel, entertainment to do for comedy, to do for hip hop live performances what Russell and Stan did for comedians and poets, which is to capture their best performances in their prime on film.
Griffin's overall goal with the company is to have a lasting impression on the media landscape, much like the Simmons-Latham Def Jam brand.
When we look at film and television, we're trying to find people who have stories to tell that resonate with the culture, that have a certain amount of integrity and authenticity. And the filmmakers have to believe something about themselves. They really have to believe that they are entitled, or in their own mind, they believe that they're chosen to tell these stories.
And like the famed oracle, Nostradamus, Will Griffin has a few predictions.
I believe that we're going to create the number one cultural projects in film and television over the next coming years. And within a decade, I believe that people will speak about urban culture, film, and television the same way they feel about urban culture, film, and music. That it is the dominant form of cultural expression in our country. And I want to be a part of it.
Boy, he did what he set out to do, didn't he?
Yeah, he did, and he's right about there being a lot of demand for it out there. It's incredible.
He said, show me the money, and he did.
Yeah, I'll tell you.
Well, Will's advice for others is to simply believe in your idea. He says, success and failure are separated only by the desire to stick to your idea and work on it until it happens.
Well, I need to remember that myself. Still ahead, our studio guest, Monique Guild, a business consultant who teaches intuitive goal setting.
And here's how you can get in touch with the entrepreneurs you've met on today's show. You can reach Albert Torres at alberttorresevents.com, and you can contact Will Griffin at simmonslathan.com. And now here's Emmett Miller with today's studio guest, Monique Guild.
All right, Lynette, thanks. Monique Guild conducts workshops on intuitive goal strategies for individuals and corporations, helping CEOs and corporate executives with their careers and their financial status. Welcome to Making It.
Oh, thank you so much for having me here.
You are an intuitive and a wealth builder. What exactly is
business intuitive? I'm able to work with corporations, businesses, and individuals that are stuck or blocked in business, and I'm able to go into the company and I literally see, if you will, the blocks, and I see the gifts, and I help turn it around, turn mm-hmm. the company or bring it up to another level, and I work with people in achieving more prosperity and things like that in their mm-hmm. business too.
What actually are the blocks that they have that you can see, and then how do you help them get rid of them?
Some of those blocks could be things like grief, resentment, negative thinking. It's really important to have people around in your life that are supportive of you. Also, too, to make sure that your thoughts are supporting you, that you're in the solution, healing resentments, healing things like that are really important. They really can become incredible blocks in one's life and business.
But some of this stuff is very convoluted for a business. This is stuff that goes on between people. It's stuff that goes on in the business dealings. How do you actually go in and see this stuff well enough to tell them to be able to get rid of it?
When it doesn't matter if I'm working with a Fortune 500 company or if I'm working with an individual, because I'm always working with the CEO or the individual themselves. A bunch of individuals. And I'm able to, I literally, if you will, I get downloaded with information. My dad is a psychiatrist, and he could have a person walk in the door or a patient walk in the door and really give you a pretty good rundown on them before they even open their mouth. Mm-hmm. And my grandmother's the same way, mm-hmm. and I'm the same way, and I have a very extensive business background, and the two have come together. So it's actually not so convoluted.
Is this something each of us has, or is this something that you
yes.
were born with?
I was born with it, and it was actually highly developed as a kid, but we're all intuitive. It's like instincts. You know, when you're walking down the street, and all of a sudden you have a feeling inside of
sure,
you that something
sure.
doesn't feel quite right. Or say somebody walks into the room and all of a sudden you feel this wonderful energy about this person. You have a good feeling, a good vibe.
Mm-hmm.
Or some people, you know, have strongly developed intuitions. They get intuitive insights in their dreams, or they'll have a hunch, you know,
sure.
in their stomach, a
sure.
feeling, things like that. So, yeah, we all have it, though.
Now, a lot of the people that we're talking about on today's show are ordinary people that have overcome extraordinary obstacles to be successful. How does
yeah.
this relate to what they did?
Wow, I listened to both the interviews. I mean, amazing. They were both very, very clear. Will knew exactly what he wanted and was very clear and precise in his steps. Now, Albert, he knew he had obstacles or blocks, if you will, to overcome.
Right.
And he, you know, with amazing perseverance, healed what he needed to heal and continues to heal those blocks. And then he saw how, you know, his addiction switched addictions, and then he healed that. So we need to heal those blocks. And now he's able to put all that energy into his business and move forward.
How do you and I do this as small business owners?
Give me an example. What do you mean, how do we do
it? I mean, how do we overcome those kind of obstacles? What sort of, you were talking to me a little bit about positive energy, positive
yes.
thinking, and how important that is.
Yeah.
What would you say for people at home to do about this?
Okay, people at home, get very clear with what you want. Very, very clear with what you want. Why do you want what it is you want? For example, if you want to buy a 3-bedroom, 2-bath house, why do you want it to be 3 bedrooms? Why not 2 bedrooms or 1 bedroom? Mm. Why 3 bedrooms? Why 2 baths? And then, okay, so why do you want it? And then how is it going to make you feel to actually be living in the 3-bedroom, 2-bath house with a huge backyard or whatever it is your detail is that you want in your life? And it's the feeling state that actually attracts things into our life. And it's been scientifically, physically, if you will, proven that what we feel really vibrates out into the universe and we attract where we are in our life.
So not just the mechanics of how to put this whole thing together. You're saying focus on what it's going to be like to be successful at doing it, not just how you're going to be successful at doing
right.
it.
Right. What's it going to feel like? How's it success? And let's say you've never had success in this area before. Well, then borrow, if you will, from another area that you have felt great in and say, gosh, I remember that time that I was with my friend and we felt really great accomplishing X, Y, and Z. Go and borrow that feeling if you need to. That sort of thing.
Fabulous, fabulous. We have to leave it there.
Yeah.
Thank you very
great
much.
Great stuff.
Thank you
so much for having me on.
And we're going to tell you in just a minute, we promise, we're going to tell you how you can reach, exactly how you can reach Monique Guild right after break.
Where small business is the big idea. Making It is being brought to you by Honda, the power of dreams. Also by the Disneyland Resort in California, where you can experience a whole new world of magic at every turn. And by Sempra Energy, a Fortune 500 energy services company committed to building a diverse supplier base.
Okay, you can reach Monique Guild at moniqueguild.com.
And if you'd like to get a copy of today's show or to find other small business resources, just log on to our website at makingittv.com.
And that's it for our show this week. I'm Emmett Miller. Thanks for joining us.
And I'm Lynette Romero. We'll see you next time right here on Making It.
I'm not the preachy type. It's really, you know, kind of like a private, you know, prayer closet for me. But I believe that if you have it in your mind and you have an imagination for it, I think that, you know, God is the person who puts that in your mind, and he wouldn't have set you up to have those expectations if it wasn't going to come to pass for you.